Good morning. Can you hear me? Oh, good. I'm so glad. My mic fell off backstage, so. Oh my gosh, now I got to put it back on. So we're going to continue today before the ordination. We're going to give a little bit of a talk on the April month theme. If you've not been here, I'll let you know what's happening is we're shooting videos for this year for the coming 2016 themes. And the theme for this year is a kinship, or the theme for April, which is the month we're doing, is kinship with all life. And what we believe is in the kinship of all life, and the kinship of all life means that we believe that everything operates as a unit, that there is only one thing that is ever going on, one thing that is ever happening, and that one thing is God. We believe that spirit is an intelligence which permeates all things, and that that intelligence exists in every single thing that exists on this planet and in our observation, because what the form of the thing is the manifestation and individualization that we make of that particular idea or that thing. I'll give you an idea of what I'm talking about. I remember one of my favorite stories came from Barbara Marx Hubbard. And Barbara Marx Hubbard talked about, can you imagine being a disembodied entity going back 50, 60, 100, 200, 500,000 years, where you stand in the middle of this planet right here, and right where we're standing, you look around, and what you see the primordial ooze, you see the formation of rocks, the coming together of life itself for the first time in all time. And then you have this angel that comes and visits you, and that angel says to you, can you look around and can you see everything, and do you believe that one day that rock over there will rise and have dominion over the planet? And she said that that is the answer of what we are, that there is an evolutionary cycle that has begun from the beginning of time that continues even today, and that takes into consideration everything and all thing that has ever been created. And that there is a mineral consciousness, there is a plant consciousness, there is an animal consciousness, and there is a human consciousness, and there is a divine consciousness. And that what we are is we are the natural state of the evolution as we grow through it and expand into it, and we always have been and we always will be, and what we are doing is the expansion of the understanding and the appreciation of the intelligence itself all around us. And that when we rose to a place where we could understand and appreciate that we think, therefore we are, and therefore have an individualization that's with it, what happens is all of the power of the universe is adapted and given to us so that we might operate and live our lives in that way. And that coming into this form, what we do is we create our experience through our observation, we create our experience through our feelings and our emotions, and that the end result of that experience is the life that we live. And that if we could see and we could actually find ourselves in a situation where we were in connection and connectivity with the spiritual mind, the divine mind itself, the end result is we would see that there is only one thing happening. And that one thing is the evolution of life itself. So that when we find ourselves in situations and circumstances on this planet Earth as this relatively immature consciousness, thinking that we are the egotism of life itself and that we are the center in some way, in one way, that the end result is that we get to create our own experience through that idea and that ideal. And we move forward. But in fact, there is a kinship of all life, and we are connected. And what I do to my brother, what I do to my sister, what I do to my environment, I indeed do to myself. What happens is that one thing that is operating and moving is the only thing that has any consequence or value. So we had 4 weeks in the month of April that we were going to talk about. And I talked about that one mind, and on April 3rd, this was written by Dr. Karen Kushner from Princeton, New Jersey. And she states, Ernest Holmes' statement, that we believe in healing through the power of that one mind. Now, you have to understand that the term healing really comes from the word ha, which means whole. So we believe in the wholeness of life coming through that one mind, our ability to be able to do that. So if we set aside our own trials, our own tribulations, our own discomforts, our own diseases, That the end result is that we have the ability through that mind to be able to get back and fit in with the congruent nature of spirit itself, which is perfect, whole, and complete at all times. And that we expand through that to develop and to grow into a different form, a different idea, a different ideal, and a different thought, which indeed brings into being a different form for us to have. The quote that she used was, "We must take the science of mind into everyday life. And when we find ourselves confronted by discordant conditions, we should never say, 'Oh, what's the use? What's the use?' But rather say, 'There is something in me, something in you, which is greater than this condition, and it can dissolve it.' We have the privilege and the power to do this, and if we use this ability properly, it will be productive and of salutary results." He also wrote, "Know your own mind, train yourself to think what you wish to think, be what you wish to be, feel what you wish to feel, and place no limit on principle." You can transform your life. You can bring your life into wholeness through the use of your own mind. It's possible for us to be able to transform the conditions of our existence and our experience. And it might not appear as though they change on the outside, but when they change on the inside, they automatically change outer. So we live in a world that, you read the letter, that has an appearance, a perception of conflict. And what we're really doing is we're evolving into the wholeness of being and the wholeness of life. To go back to Barbara Marx Hubbard's quote, is that if you can imagine the trial and the tribulation that that rock went through in order to become the form that sits here now, everything moves us towards that. And we are moving from that mineral consciousness. We've moved from the mineral consciousness into the plant consciousness. From the plant consciousness, we evolved into the animal consciousness. From the animal consciousness, we evolved into human consciousness. And from this human consciousness, I know not where we go, except that at some point we will be reunited with the divine consciousness itself, which is the congruent consciousness that sees life as a whole, as opposed to seeing it as an individualized trial that we have to move through. And that moves us to the second week, which is April 10th, which was written by Dr. Petra Weldes from Dallas. She put it together. And what our belief is here, what the value that we put forward here is, we see a world that is our religious understanding. We see a world in which we live and grow as one global family that respects and honors the interconnectedness of all life. In other words, what we do as a movement, as the New Thought movement per se, is we recognize a world that is interconnected. We might live in the individualized place where pain happens. We might live in the individualized place where we have those emotional little charges. Do you have emotional little charges? I have emotional little charges. I was sitting over here after Neil sang the song, I asked him, bawling my eyes out. I don't know why. I don't have a clue. All I know is there's something about someone singing a song because you happen to mention it at a party on Friday night, specifically for you, the givingness of life. How little it takes, or how big, because I know Neil must have worked very hard because he didn't know it, but how little it takes to transform the life. The interconnectedness of all life. What can we do today for another human being that would help bring that together for them? Help them feel and sense that knowledge. Because that's what we believe. We believe in that tying together of everything and how it fits together in perfection. And we believe that only one thing is happening. Can you imagine if we reacted to the issues that we see in the world around us from a place of love as opposed to a place of vengeance or fear, so that what we can do is we can move to help people develop, help people grow, help people move forward. Instead of saying, no, we're going to withhold, or we're going to punish, or we're going to have violent action, or we're going to think violently towards you in itself. This is the human condition. It is the human consciousness. It is not who we are. There is a kinship with all life. We cannot anymore afford to be able to do that. That's why we're expanding. And if you look around you and sense what's happening in the world, you see it's already taking place. You wouldn't even be here unless it was taking place within you. That is part of it. It's that growth and that development. And what I say is that we can accelerate our appreciation of the interconnectedness of all life by being aware of it and living it and moving through it. The third week was also written by Dr. Petra from Dallas, Texas, and the theme is, we believe that the manifest universe is the body of God. It's all God. We believe in this system of the mineral, the plant, the animal, the human, and so on and so on and so on. And we believe that it is all one thing, and that what that is spirit. And when we use the word God, or when I use the word God, I fear sometimes that what I'm doing is I'm misrepresenting, because we have a traditional concept of what God is. I believe that God is life, period. That's my favorite word for it, is a capital L, life. Some people use spirit, some people use Allah, some people use Rajneesh, some people use Jesus. It doesn't matter. It is representative of life itself, because there is that one mind. That's all there is. And it operates, and we individualize it, and then we use it for our own purpose. And when we do treatment work, what we do is we do the steps of treatment, and we step back and we rise up. And when we rise up, what we see is we see a completeness of life, a wholeness of life, as opposed to the individual minutiae which creates the issues that seem to run rampant in our life around us. And the challenge for me, might not be for you, but the challenge for me is in times of need to really, really reach out and embrace that instead of run away from it. Dr. Holmes said, to desert the truth in time of need is not to know the truth. To desert the truth in time of need is not to know the truth. And time of need is when we find ourselves in a situation where we don't know the answer. We find ourselves in a situation where we're confronted. We find ourselves in a situation where we're conflicted. We find ourselves in a situation where we are afraid. And that's the time to go to that place and understand that there is only the one. Years ago in a theater, I was trying to rent for one of our Sunday services. I remember I walked in and there was the theater manager was there. It wasn't this theater. There was a theater manager that was there. And immediately we began to lock horns. And I could tell the conversation wasn't going the way I wanted to go. I could tell there was a conflict that was happening, and it was escalating. I could feel it. Do you know what I'm talking about? Have you ever had that conversation? You're standing with someone, and it seems like it starts off perfectly normal, and the next thing you know, all your buttons are being pushed, and things are growing and expanding, or am I the only one who's ever done that? Good. Well, I'm glad. My three fans must support me. Anyway, there it is. There it lays before you. And there I am in this conversation. And for one brief second, when it was really escalating, I suddenly remembered to go back to the principle. And so I took a breath. And I didn't move physically, but mentally I stepped back so that I could allow some space. And instantaneously, it changed. Suddenly, the conversation just flipped. What it was a matter of transforming my personality, my idea, my problem, my judgment, despite the fact he was totally wrong. Well, really, to this day, I know it. But the thing is that the cause of the issue was coming from me, not from him. And that's what needed to be understood. Anybody here got a job? Maybe perhaps they have a little bit of conflict with somebody that they work with. Is that possible? Does that happen? Okay. It doesn't happen for you. So let me give you an example of how it does happen. So lots of times in the workplace, what happens is you have somebody who seems to be applying pressure to you all the time. You have somebody who you seem to not be getting along with. Try this. Try stepping back and removing that energy. Stepping back and allowing that light of love and appreciation and recognition that there's only one thing that's happening to take place. And allow that to neutralize what the situation is. Totally neutralize it. And then step back in again. Then go to work. That's called spiritual practice. And it's an important thing to do, especially if you happen to believe that the manifest universe is the universe of God, that you are an individualization of God, and that you are connected, and that there's only the one thing that is happening no matter what. The quote that Dr. Petra used for this one is, there's a great difference between saying I am God and saying God is me. Ice is water, all ice is some water, but not all water is ice. So we might say of the life of humanity, all of our life is some of the life of God. Some of the life of God is all of our life. But we're not all of the life of God. I'm convinced that whatever my life is, it is God. And there is no difference between my life and God in essence. The difference is in the degree. Now, it's like this. Michael Beckwith said last week when I was with him, he said, imagine there is an ocean. We've all heard the story. And we are but a wave on the ocean. He said, that means that we're not the fish. Okay? We're not the mussels. We're not the crabs. We're not the lobster. We're not the seaweed. We are the water in the ocean itself. And that we are a part of it that we particularize at any given time. And we are not of it. We are actually it. And that is the belief of this teaching. The belief of this teaching is that we have this little framework of our life within an infinite potential and possibility. And that we live within this little box of our own consciousness, our own belief system, of what we hold to be true at any given time. I am man, you are woman, I am white, you are black, I am right, you are wrong, I am tall, you are short, I am smart, you are dumb. It's all a matter of perception, but it's all just the one thing. And that if we had the potential and the possibility, which we do, to expand that box, to expand the idea, what happens is the form around us transforms at the same time. So that as we expand in a greater idea of what life is, life becomes more to us than we hold within our constant belief that this has to be true. So if it comes to disease, if you can expand your idea bigger, what happens is the disease dissipates and disappears because it no longer fits within the confines of your idea of life. Am I making sense? If you expand your idea of peace and the potentiality, it all expands with it and the form changes at the same time. If you expand your idea about love in your life and your relationship, what happens is everything changes and transforms to attract that into your life or dissolve that which is in your life which used to fit within the confines of that small idea. So what we are about is growing the idea of life within our own selves so that what we can do is we can grow out to the acceptance that this is the totality. And then keep growing that totality to a larger and larger potential on a regular basis, and therefore having a larger, more peaceful and more harmonious relationship with the world around us as we do it. And right now we're stuck in this idea that says there isn't enough money. We're stuck in this idea that says there isn't enough love. We're stuck in this idea that says we need to use violence in the world. And in order to transform and transcend that, we need to grow our consciousness to be larger. Because I'll tell you something, is that as our consciousness grows to be larger, there is the consciousness of humanity, the collective consciousness, which also grows larger. And what we're in right now in our life is we are in an expanding, evolving time of the consciousness of the collective. That's what's happening to us. The world is transforming before our eyes, and we're still seeing the bits and pieces that were problems before. We have yet to grow out of them, to see them for the opportunities or the growth or the evolution that is possible to take place in our world around us if but we live in this zone and allow ourselves to be able to expand the ideas of life around us. And we're the cutting edge of that. Not we in this church, but we who are of the belief that we can transform the world through transforming our own minds and our own ideas, because we're prepared to step forward and take responsibility for what we think. And when we take responsibility for what we think, we stop being a slave to the archaic, ancient, old ideas and beliefs that we actually brought forward from the animal consciousness, that we actually adopted from them, that reptilian brain idea of fight or flight, to be able to step into a world where what we get to do is we get to access the truth. Now, the challenge is to see it in times of need and not to desert it when we feel we require it. In other words, when you're in that conflictual situation, to remember that you can transform it by transforming your idea about what goes with it. When you pick up the newspaper and read about yet again another violent act, you can transform it by recognizing and knowing of the wholeness of life and expanding your belief that holds the archaic way of thinking that says that person should be punished, this should happen, this should go on, this is the way it's got to work, and start becoming proactive in how we deal with life and how we deal with the world. Have you noticed just in the last couple of days how the mindset and the collective consciousness in North America has transformed over the Syrian refugee crisis? Have you picked up on that? Okay, I'm not politically speaking here, so believe what you want to believe. But I will tell you, how can it be that 2 weeks ago, when I saw the body of the four-year-old wash up on the beach in Greece, that I can say, oh my God, we have to find a home for 2.5 million people that are fleeing the terror of their country. And then 2 weeks later, have an attack in Paris planned by ISIS, which are what these people are trying to escape, and find myself suddenly hearing the commotion saying, oh, I think we better think this over. That is a step backwards. This one here was the step into compassion. It was the step into reality. It was the step into truth. It was the step into the idea that maybe perhaps we're past the idea of thinking that there's them or us, and that there really is only us, and that what we should do is quit saying they're different than we are, because why? They live on the other side of the world? They're the same. And once we get that, and once we understand that, which we do, and we see something of humanity that raises the compassion in us, and we say, let's welcome them in, and then immediately something occurs, and we go back to the way we used to think. To desert the truth in time of need is not to know the truth. So we must go back and connect with that. We have to know that it's not about Syria. It's about life. It's about us. It's about the compassion of being that we have in the world around us. And that what we keep emulating what we've done before. World War I, World War II, etc., etc., etc. We keep going back and doing the same thing over and over again, expecting that we're going to get a different result from it, and we never do. But every time we take the step and we move from the archaic to the creative, what happens is all of a sudden the world transforms another step. It moves forward. The box expands. And the pressure jams us back together again. Our job is to expand the box. And not expand it because we want to be right. Think about it. Look at it. What is the difference? Understand the rightness that's within you. You all know, this whole world knows the difference between right and wrong. There's a few that probably don't. But we, as average people in the world, know the difference between right and wrong. And that is spirit moving through everything. The fourth week, which is April 24th, fits right in with that. It says, we see a world in which kinship with all life prospers. Kinship with all life prospers. And this was written by Reverend Angelica Jane Taggart, who used to be in Vancouver, but is down in Washington State now. And her quote from Dr. Holmes is, all nature shows a divine relatedness. I have but to contemplate the blade of grass, the growing leaf, or the solar system, to see that he or it who has created me has shaped and arranged all things to prosper and to exist in harmony. And another one that I chose was, all life is one life. Just as every physical substance knows and derives from one universal energy, so there is but one life principle, which is God, in which we all live and from which infinite source our individual lives are drawn. We know that this whole life has been put together in perfection. We know it with the exception of our own selves and our own beings. I've said this many times before. We look at the world around us, and through science and through technology, we understand that everything has a purpose. We truly do. We understand that a gnat has a purpose, and if you remove the gnat from the world, you remove the bird that eats the gnat. And if you remove the bird, you remove the cat that ate the bird, etc., etc. That there's always a connection that flows and that moves with it, and we believe and we hold that true from the mineral to the plant to the animal, and then we come to the human, and for some reason we think that it stops there, that it blocks off. And the truth is, it doesn't. If we were to live our true lives, we would live in a true life. And if we do that, in order to do it, what we have to do is become authentic as human beings. We have to become real in who we are. And it becomes our responsibility to be able to fit into that life as that realness that we talk about. It's the only way that we're going to transform the world. The only way that we're going to make a difference in the world around us is to become real enough that we can fit into the place as humanity that's made for us, that is the perfect balance that we sit there. But because we have the ability to individualize, and because we have these little fears that go on with us, what occurs to us is we get stuck in where we're at in that little box. And as we grow this box, what will happen is everything else will come to wholeness. It will heal through the use of the growth of that box, to go back to the very, very first value and ideal put forward. Our issue is to stop being competitive with each other. Our issue is to stop thinking that what's good for Barry might be bad for me. Our issue is to move that consciousness from the idea of the competitive consciousness that we sit in right now in that small, confined little box, and to be able to expand it so that it becomes a creative idea. And that's what humanity is doing right now. That's what the collective consciousness is moving on right now. It is moving from that competitive consciousness into the creative consciousness. And we see huge parts of our world that have already succeeded in getting there. And then what we need to do is follow that and move with it. We see the advancement that's taking place in the creative minds of individuals all over the planet. And yet, somehow or other, I don't know about you, but I kind of dig my heels in sometimes and don't want to move there. But that's it. That's it right there. When I drive down the street and see a homeless person, what do I think? How do I act to that? What is my first notion? What happens? When I see a piece of trash on the road, do I bother to pick it up and put it away because it's good for the planet? Or do I think it's somebody else's responsibility? Where do I fit into the plane of what's going on, to the transformation of this consciousness, to this ideal that's coming forward, to the evolution of humanity? The only place that I can think of to fit in is to continue to evolve. To continue to move forward and move away from that competitive urge and move into a creative urge. So that I know that I'm responsible for my environment. I know I'm responsible for my life. I know I'm responsible for my love. I know I'm responsible for my body. I know I'm responsible for my community. I know I'm responsible for the world. And I know I'm responsible for you. not in a way that I'm codependent, but in a way that allows me to be able to live my life in a way that does not harm anyone, hurt anyone, and does only good to raise life up. These are the type of people, this is who I want to be, and it's the type of people I want you to be. I want the world to be like this. And we're getting there. And thank God you're here. And bless you. Have a wonderful day.